Yeah, we're from the heart of the Edinburgh Festival. We're at Underbelly with Paul Merton and Suki Webster, who are rocking the Pleasance Grand with their improv show. I saw it on Saturday. It was absolutely brilliant.
Good, thank you. Yes,
yeah,
we're having
thank
fun.
You.
Sold out house.
Yes, yeah, we're doing very well. I think tickets are still available on the day, but by the time we get to the venue about an hour before the show, they generally are sold out. So, you know, if you get there about 10 o'clock in the morning or online booking, I suppose it's called, is it?
Yes.
That's what the kids are doing, Paul.
Yes, exactly.
I don't think
there's anything wrong with putting a card in a newsagent's window. That's how I think you should spread information, don't you?
I don't know.
No?
I think I've moved forward.
Have you?
But, yeah.
Two cards in the newsagent's window. Yeah, so it's going very well. So we're very happy so far, yeah.
And you're here. You're not here for the entire festival,
no,
right?
We're doing 11 days, aren't we?
Yeah, so we start on the 9th and we finish on the 19th.
Is that a sort of a decision that you've made to sort of come in, do a 10-day blast and get out?
Very much so. You have fun, but your kidney and liver survives.
Yes. I mean, I have done shows here in the past, you know, we've done 3 weeks and it's quite punishing. And some people are doing 4 weeks. I mean, it becomes very hard work, particularly if you're in a show that's not particularly successful in terms of audience appreciation or audience attention. So, I mean, I've done shows here where you walk in the rain to the venue and you get there and you find that 6 people have bought tickets and it's all very dispirited.
Yeah.
And after about 3 weeks, it can get to you a bit. So we come in, do the 10, 11 days, have fun, and then off we go.
Is this your 10th, 11th, 12th, more?
Oh, more, so...
Well, the Impro Show was Impro Chums. We started that in 2004, didn't we?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
So and obviously, there was those few years of the pandemic.
Yeah.
But I think, yeah, that if there hadn't been, that would be 20, so probably 18.
And that's just with the improv show. I mean, I was up here doing stand-up before as well. I did 3 weeks back in 88, so 3 weeks in 84, 3 weeks in 85 and 86. So, yeah, it all adds up.
So that experience you were talking about you know, trudging in the rain to an empty house, 3 weeks on, no more people.
Well, there was one...
Was that your first one? Was that your first Edinburgh?
No, the first one was actually quite successful because we had, unbelievably, there were very few stand-ups doing the festival. This was 1984.
Right.
And I was in a show with 3 other male stand-ups. And we reckoned there was about 3 other shows that had stand-ups in them.
Wow.
And that's all there was. The rest of the comedy then was kind of review groups, sketch shows, that sort of thing. That was about the last time you had a very small number of stand-ups here. Then 85, there was more than 86, and it sort of, the floodgates opened then. But yeah, 86 was when I played the Pleasance, and that's when we had sort of like, you know, we weren't doing particularly well. And I remember towards the end of that 3 week run, I was walking from George Street to try and find the Pleasance, a journey I'd done every day for 3 weeks, and I couldn't remember how to get there. My brain said, look, I'm not taking you there. You're going to have to do it on your own. So I had to walk along and say, okay, now I know I turn right here. Now what's here? Okay, I recognise that bit. I think it's left here. I had to do it like putting together a jigsaw puzzle. We're being handed the pieces one at a time. So yeah, it was extraordinary. I couldn't remember how to get there.
It must be quite traumatic to have that experience. 3 weeks, you're thinking, especially because you're sort of buying into the myth that this could be a launch pad.
Yes.
You know,
and it is a myth, I think, in many ways. I mean, there are very, very few people who have ever launched their career on the back of a successful Edinburgh run. I mean, famously, of course, comedy historians will remember Beyond the Fringe, which wasn't even part of the Fringe, but Peter Cook, Dudley Moore, Alan Bennett, Jonathan Miller, and then Rowan Atkinson made a big impact up here as well in, I think, like late 70s. But generally speaking, there are very few people. If you think of the thousands of people who have been coming up here over the decades, very few actually build a career, unless they win what the Perrier Award used to be or whatever it's called now, I don't know. That could possibly be a launch pad, but there are some people who have won that award and have disappeared since. Yeah.
Right, so it's no guarantee.
It's no guarantee at all, no.
No guarantee.
Would you encourage sort of young performers, be they comedians or otherwise, Suki, to, you know, to give it a bash, the Edinburgh Fringe, or do you think you have to be a little bit battle-hardened to even try your luck here?
I think if you think it's for you, it probably will be, but be a little battle-hardened. But don't come up with the expectation that it's going to launch your career. Come up with the expectation that doing a show every day is really going to help you craft
yes.
what you're doing. You're going to have a fabulous time. If you're young, you're going to party and play. So do it because you're going to enjoy it. Don't do it, and because it will help you shape yourself.
Right.
Don't do it thinking, oh, by the time I go home, I'll have a TV contract.
Yeah.
It's probably you won't.
And build some days off in, definitely. But
yes.
yeah, that point you make there about sort of doing it every day is very important, because if you can do like let's say 18 shows in 3 weeks instead of 18 shows in a year,
yeah.
you can learn more over that period because you can say, that thing I did yesterday didn't work, I'm not going to do that again. You can remember your mistakes, but also build on your successes. And that's a great way of doing it. It's a kind of crash course to give you some, a bit of experience yeah. in a very short space of time.
Let's talk a little bit about sort of how, what led you to your comedy careers, if we can. And as I sort of explained earlier, we populate this chat with a soundtrack, and we prefer it was of your choosing. So let's ask both of you for the first record that you ever remember buying as a youngster. Would you remember, Suki?
Yes, it was a compilation album.
Nice.
And I remember it had Crazy Horses by the Osmonds on.
Doesn't get any better than that.
That's about, Hey, I'm Going to Barbados. It had that on
totally
it.
Totally Tropical.
Totally yes. Tropical, yeah. Thank you. Can't remember anything else that was on it. And I think it cost about 25 pence,
bargain.
Something like that.
Excellent. And for you, Paul?
Yes, the first record I bought was with the Bloons. It was quite a long time ago.
Right.
It was before we
1920
had... 1920? No, it was...
When you were a pirate.
When I was a pirate, yeah. When I was a pirate, yeah. Pirate Radio. Yes, it was a record by Georgie Fame called The Ballad of Bonnie and Clyde.
Oh, I remember that.
Which was about, I'm pretty sure, 1967. So that was the first... And the reason why I liked it as well, I think, was there were sound effects on the record, like gunfire and things. Coming off the back of the popularity of the film, nothing to do with the film, but coming off the popularity of the Bonnie and Clyde film that had come out that year. And on top of the pops, they sort of did this curious sort of visual trick where they merged photographs and moving images of cops on American streets with Georgie Fame playing, and I was excited by that mixture of the images. So that was the first record I bought.
What about growing up? I mean, there's sort of a stereotype of comedians being, I don't know, socially awkward or weren't very popular at school, or and that's sort of how they either got attention or got their affirmation of and a little bit of self-confidence. Do you subscribe to that, Suki?
For myself or as a general view?
Both.
Yes and no. I don't know if I was ever terribly socially awkward, but I certainly didn't feel like I fitted in completely. I can remember at school thinking, this isn't my tribe yet.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
So I was very aware even from a young age. And then the moment I went up to London and started working, it was like, yay, I found my people. I don't know if all of them are socially awkward. I think that's probably as much as there is in any walk of life. Some are, some aren't. But I do think a lot of comedians are slightly outliers. They're quite good at being out and looking in,
right?
Which is why, you know, we're all quite good at observing, and I think that is probably true. Do you
it
agree?
Is quite handy being an outsider, yes, and as you say, looking in. I think also as well, certainly I was very shy as a schoolboy, but if you can make people laugh, then of course you make friends. So that's one of the ways of getting past that.
So does that mean you were sort of class clown? Or?
Yeah, but in a subtle way. You know, I was sort of like I'd be in the back row whispering things to people rather than a very good friend of mine, when he first joined the school, he was introduced to me and he said, this is Paul, he's the class clown. And that man, who became a very good friend of mine, immediately hated me on sight, being described as that. And I hated being described as that. So it was a few years after that we actually got talking and realised we liked each other. But that introduction was enough to put both of us off.
Yeah.
I suppose I was in a way. Yeah.
How old were you when you first thought, I'm actually funnier than the other kids, or I've got something a bit special here?
I don't know if I ever thought that. I remember just loving comedy. So whether it was the books of Richmal Crompton, Just William books, I started to read, you know, I was about 9 or 10, I suppose. And you'd be listening to radio shows of that era, like the Goon Show or Hancock's Half Hour, these sort of old 50s shows. At TV, anything, the Beatles, I first got into the Beatles, not through their music necessarily, but because they were so funny. And I liked them because they were amusing and funny, you know. And
irreverent, weren't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. And, of course, that's sort of that immense charm that they had, the four of them. So anything that was funny, that was amusing, I would lap it up and just devour it.
When you sort of got into teenagerhood, let's talk about music as well, as we're on that topic. Posters on the bedroom wall, particular teenage obsessions, musically?
I didn't, no. I mean, lots of friends did. But no, I used to have lots of cartoons and, again, read lots of comedy stuff. And
oh, right, so you were writing totally, to the comedy, yeah.
Yeah, I used to watch loads of Morecambe and Wise. And but no, I mean, I loved listening to music, but I was never that fangirl for that. It, yeah.
How about, so thing. When did comedy first sort of emerge as a possibility for you as a young adult of like, well, I think I could have a go at this?
Do you know, I just, like most things, I just fell into them. So I, unlike Paul, who at a very early age decided that's what I was, he was going to do, I fancied somebody. They invited me to a workshop and I got a career out of it. Went on one date with him. He was very dull and that didn't happen. So,
but it led you down the, a good
yeah,
path.
Yeah, yeah. I like so that. Thank you.
But you, Paul, as Suki said, you sort of knew from a...
Yeah, the posters on my bedroom wall were Harold Lloyd hanging off the clock in Safety Last. That's quite a famous image. The yeah. spectacle came in. Charlie Chaplin, Buster Keaton, Laurel and Hardy. Yeah, these were the posters I had on my wall. I was very... I was determined that I didn't know whether I could make a career out of comedy, because certainly growing up in the 70s, the options to become a comedian were very limited if you lived in London or in the South, because essentially the routes were either Cambridge Footlights, I was too stupid for that, there was Northern Working Men's Clubs, I was too Southern for that, too shy for that, holiday camps, red coat, blue coats, that yeah. sort of thing, that's how some people got into it. So it wasn't until the Comedy Store opened up in 1979 where essentially anybody could get up and give it a go, and they might, you know, they might not be any good, but at least there was a chance to get some stage time. That's when it really, I realised there was a way in. But for years I had the ambition, but I had no idea of how I was ever going to get there.
So was the very first time you did a stand-up routine at the Comedy Store?
Yeah, more or less it was, yeah. Yeah, it was April 1982. And
Do you remember it?
Oh, I remember it very clearly. I had this idea. I'd seen a news item. There was a police operation called Operation Julie in Wales in the late 1970s, where there were some people who were making the drug LSD, obviously illegally, in this factory.
Right.
And the police came in and saw there was a raid. And there was some hallucinogenic dust in the air, which they ingested, and they know about this. So there was a documentary, and I remember these two policemen are sitting in a bar, and... And they said, well, when did you first notice that there was something wrong, you know? And one of them said, well, I was sitting in the bar here with Detective Inspector Norris when I noticed that my pint of beer was getting bigger. And it was that. And I was standing at a bus stop in a pouring rain, and it suddenly popped into my head. And I thought, oh, there's a really good idea for a monologue. So I abandoned whatever journey I was on. I went back to the bedsit and just started writing this idea, the combination of the rather dry policeman stereotypical delivery yeah. with describing hallucinations. So I wrote this piece over the course of about 6 weeks. It was only about 3.5 minutes long, but I was determined to sort of make it as funny as I could, to either have a joke every line or definitely a line leading up to a very good joke. And because I thought, well, I don't know how funny I can be personally, but if what I'm saying is funny. So I went to the Comedy Store one night, went on about 1:30 in the morning, and they loved it. They absolutely loved it. Encore, go back, you know.
Wow.
I went back on again, but I just had to do it again because I didn't have anything else. And I walked home all the way from Soho, where the Comedy Store was then, back to my bedsit in Streatham, which is, I Googled it recently, it's about 6.5 miles. Ooh. And I got back at 7:30 in the morning. I was just so ecstatically high, because I'd had this ambition all my life. And the very first time I did it, luckily, because I'd had this great idea, it really, really worked. Now, I also knew that, okay, I don't know what I'm doing yet. I need to sort of do an apprenticeship. I need to do this for a long time. But that first gig was really, unlike most people's first gig, was an absolute triumph.
And did you sort of have downs from there?
Or, oh, yeah.
Or was that
yeah.
sort of set in the bar?
For the next 18 months, I had a 20-minute act which started really well and slowly spiraled into tedium, because I had nothing as good as this policeman recounting this story.
So in terms of, you know, your success, that, you know, obviously you've become a household name now, Paul, with... You know, Have I Got News For You, and a very long and established career. When you sort of look at, obviously, you are a student of comedy, clearly.
Yes.
And a craftsman of comedy.
So I think they've just delivered my empties.
Your recycling bin's just been
empty. Yeah, just back there.
And you craft your comedy. Is that still the case now? Do you still take as much time, or do you feel like you've done your 10,000 hours? You kind of know what you're doing.
Yeah, you do know what you're doing, but you're always open to... I mean, for example, the show we're doing here this year now, for the last 20 years, we've been coming up with a show called Paul Merton's Impro Chums. This year, it's called Paul Merton and Suki Webster's Improv Show. Not only is the title different, but there are different games that we're doing now. So you saw the show on Saturday.
Yeah.
There's the game where we get people out of the audience to move us around.
That's very funny.
Which is very funny. We haven't done that here before. So you're trying out new games. We're working with different people every day. And you've got to stay on top of it. You can't, particularly with improvisation, you can't think, oh, well, yesterday's show was great, so today's show will be great. I won't bother. You've got to be ready to do the best you can at every possibility that you've got. So you can't shortchange the audience. And with improvisation, you always got to stay on top of what you're doing and making sure that you don't get lazy or even repeat stuff you've done before, which would be the cardinal sin. It's always got to be fresh, you know.
Is improv something that you think anyone could do if they were sort of had a few lessons or learned, or is it a kind of a you've either got it or you haven't?
It's like dancing. Anyone can do it, but you wouldn't want to necessarily pay to see everyone. Do you know what I mean? The more you do, the better you'll get. But yeah. Some people will have a facility to get good quick, and some people won't.
What do you think? What's the main inhibitor? Is it the fear of looking silly? Is it the fear of exposing, you know, that you're not as intelligent as the next person or as quick-witted as the next person?
There's a combo of, I'd say, because some of it is also... If people want to be too funny too quickly and are trying too hard, that can be very difficult. If they're not good at listening and sharing the stage, that can be difficult. If they're scared of looking silly, that can be difficult. So, you know, the sweet spot of people that are really open, love being in a team and don't care too much.
Right.
And I think it's essentially, you know, there's a bit of mystique around it, because essentially what we're doing now is improvising. We don't know what you're going to ask us, you don't know what we're going to say, but your next question is based on what we've just said, and we're answering the question because we're listening to what you're asking us. So there's skills that we have anyway. I mean, I suppose the one thing is that we put the extra element in there, which is it's of the comedy, you know.
Yes.
So that's maybe the harder bit, which, you know, does... comes with experience and comes with, I mean, I've been doing it for a long time now. The very first improvised show, actually, I've just remembered, was up here in Edinburgh, which was just a sort of one-off thing. I was with a group of people, including Mike Myers, who went to Hollywood and became Austin Powers and Wayne's World and stuff,
yeah.
And he was very experienced. I remember watching him get up and doing it, and I was thinking, well, I can see what you're doing, but I can't see how you're doing it. It's extraordinary. How are you just doing this? And, of course, through working with him for about 6 months on and off, we got experience and we got better.
Talking of collaborations, it's very much a team sport, isn't it? Can sort of picking the wrong team throw everything off? I mean, do you have to very carefully cast the shows?
Yeah. But, I mean, we've tried lots of people who've never improvised before in this particular show. So we've been doing it at the Comedy Store for 5 months before we came up. And we had the brilliant Stephen Mangan, never done improvisation before.
Oh, wow.
The brilliant Jason Manford. Ross Noble, who's only used to improvising on his own. So it's a completely different form. But we met them an hour before the show, gave them a little workshop, worked out what their skill was and what their strength was, and cast them to that.
Yeah.
So every show we're trying to cast the guest in what we think and what they're telling us is their thing. So as long as you cast them right and look after them, you can chuck people in that haven't done it before. They need performance skill, obviously. I wouldn't say to my bin man, do you want to come on today?
Yeah.
But a good performer with the right attitude, you can just look after them and they'll have a fantastic time. And all three of them were like, oh my God, I wish I'd done this earlier. This is
amazing.
So much fun.
Mm. Any other sort of memorable collaborations, whether that be improv or...
I did a mini series of Room 101 on television, and I interviewed Spike Milligan, and that was, you know, when you meet somebody who's been a hero of yours since you were seven, and I had a book, Spike Milligan for Kids, writing for kids or something like that it was called. And so when you meet somebody like that, you can't help but just think, how is it possible that I'm meeting you? But here you are. And that was extraordinary.
That's a lovely pinch me moment. Of like,
it is,
if a young me could see the me now, they'd think
that's
this is bonkers.
It, totally. Absolutely, totally. That's exactly it. Yeah, you sort of thought, okay, if you take the 7-year-old version of me, this is you speaking to Spike Milligan, you'd probably just explode with joy.
Have you had any sort of similar experience, Suki?
Yes, and do you know, this is so silly because I've forgotten his name. I did a TV show in, it was filmed in Lithuania, it was an acting job, and I worked with the Hammer Horror star.
Christopher Lee.
Christopher Lee, how did that go out my head?
Oh, wow.
And, oh, my God, the director said to me, oh, I'm going to meet Mr. Lee for tea. Would anyone like to come? I was like, yes, yes. And we sat down, and he picked up his teacup, and his little finger was out, and it had a crook in it. And he saw my eye go to his finger, and he went, Bette Davis and Errol Flynn, 19 whatever it was. And he was off with endless Hollywood stories. He covered Billy Wilder. He covered it. Do you know what I mean? It
How
was
amazing.
Just... And I was just sat there lapping it up. It was great.
What about Peter O'Toole?
Yes. I did a show in the West End with Susie Eddie Izzard. And people used to come back, and Susie would always stand at the green room door. And most of the big names would maybe give the rest of the cast a cursory glance. But normally they'd just talk to Susie and she'd have a chat with them and they'd go on their way.
Yeah.
But Peter O'Toole arrived and Susie's there ready to meet Peter. Peter brushed past Susie if she didn't exist, ran across the room, lifted me up in his arms, twirled me around, went, my darling, I must hear all about you.
Oh, my goodness. And you were off.
Yeah, I was so flattered. And
your feet literally didn't touch the ground.
Yeah, I was walking on air and literally didn't come back down. And, oh, my stars, he was probably 60 or 60... odd then, and I was in my late 20s, but those green eyes, oh wow.
They didn't dim.
They didn't dim.
When I have musical guests on, which is most of the time, sort of people who've been in bands for 30, 40 years, we sort of talk about the pinnacle moment for British musicians is getting on to be Top of the Pops.
Yes.
Then your mum and dad believe that you're a musician, all your friends and neighbours do, it's sort of the stamp of legitimacy. What's the sort of the comedy equivalent for that?
Well, for me, certainly, was the first time I appeared on television. And my parents, this is when they stopped leaving newspapers lying around with jobs circled in ink for me to see. And they naturally assumed then that I'd be on television forever, which turned out to be the case. But
what was the first one?
Oh, it was a show called Pranksters, which was a BBC documentary, part of a 40-minute, they used to call it 40-minute strand, I think. And it was just a show about where there was a firm that if you wanted somebody to sort of come in and say, turn up at a wedding, heavily pregnant, saying you are the father of my child. Doesn't sound particularly amusing, but that's the sort of thing that people would pay other people to come along and do. So it was that sort of thing. And I was playing the part of a, not very plausible, but I was a policeman. I was walking around without any trousers and I had to knock on this woman's back door and say, excuse me, I've been mugged by a couple of people and I think my trousers are in your back garden. Will you help me look for them? I mean, it's not, you know,
wasn't your top shelf comedy line?
No, I hadn't come up with this. But I was quite cute, so she put up with me for a while. But we lived together for 6 years now, come to think about it. No, we didn't.
And that was the first time you're on telly and everything.
That was it, more or less. Yeah, I think it was. Yeah, I think it was the first one.
The big show, of course, was Have I Got News For You?
Yes.
That was massive.
Yes.
Where do you sort of view that? It's like the big album for a musician. That was sort of the big show.
Yeah,
that catapulted you from perhaps, you know, people.
Yeah,
who are
I suppose
into comedy,
I'd done Whose Line Is It Anyway, so I was known for that a little bit. And I started doing that from 1988, and Have I started in 1990. So I suppose, yeah, I mean, it still is. I mean, our next series starts in October. We've got a new government to talk about, and other news stories, and the presidential election coming up, so there won't be any shortage of material. It rolls on, it continues to, and a bit like going back to the point about never getting complacent, you always have to do the show to the best of your ability. You can't rest on your laurels. Everybody that works on the show is very experienced, and you're always doing your best to make it as good as you can.
Who's been sort of most surprising guest for you in terms of you thought, oh, this is going to be hard work, and actually they were fantastic?
When John Sargent was on first on, because we just knew him as a sort of serious news journalist, he was very funny, so that was amusing. But I can say who was my favourite host and who was my least favourite host.
Go on.
My least favourite host was Anne Widdecombe, which marked the the absolute lowest point of my professional career when she turned to me and she said, come on, be funny, that's what you're being paid for.
Nice.
So to hear that career advice from the hilarious Anne Widdecombe was something that I shall always treasure. But of course, Bruce Forsyth hosted it.
That was
the one. And that was the show that led to him doing Strictly. Because his ITV stuff had dried up a bit. He was still full of enthusiasm and energy and talent. But he was feeling a little bit sort of like, you know, maybe his best days had gone. But it was such a hit on that the BBC then said, do you want to host this new dancing show? Oh, yeah, I'll be good at that. Yeah, I'll be good. So he did, yeah, and off he went.
How amazing.
Yeah.
How about for you, Susie? Sort of, you know, favourite sort of highlight moments for you of the career thus far?
Well, doing the motorhoming series for Channel 5 was fantastic. But when you were talking about bands, a story that popped in my head was I was a backing vocalist in a band years ago. Yeah. Called Stratacruisers, and we were a three-chord wonder band that, you know, did pub rooms and stuff. But we had very good management, and we ended up being flown out to Tokyo and doing Michiko Kishino's fashion show to 4,000 people a night.
Wow!
So that was, you know, kind of the pinnacle of my one and only bit of music career, was what I remember thinking. But I've been lucky. I mean, I haven't had the success Paul has had, but I've had so many great things, you know, working with Christopher Lee, being in the West End with Susie Izard, doing, you know, I've managed to keep working and have lots of fun things that I've done.
That is the definition of a successful career in show business, to keep working.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? Especially for any kind of longevity. And also, clearly, Paul's a one-trick pony, and Suki, you're a jack of all trades.
That's
you're
it.
Acting,
jack of
you're
all,
singing,
master of none.
I don't know if I like being compared to a pony.
In the nicest possible sense.
A racehorse would be better.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe not. I sell with pony. They're quite cute, aren't they, ponies? Yeah. Give them an apple.
I think thinking of yourself as a racehorse is probably ideas of grandeur.
Is it really? Do you think so? Just stick with pony.
Stick with pony.
The motorhoming show is fantastic, and I think there's for people of a certain age who are all, you know, pondering, myself included, we should do that. We should try that out as a
fun
holiday. Did it sort of get you hooked? I mean, obviously it was for a TV show, but was it something that love to do?
I mean, yeah, absolutely. I mean, my advice would be to anybody who's considering it, is they are very expensive vehicles, so rent one. Rent one and see
try
how you
it.
Think. But I mean, if you think you're going to enjoy it, you probably will, because the great thing about it is if you're going to go on holiday and it's Saturday morning, so instead of going to a major airport like Heathrow and taking your belt off and your shoes and queuing up and waiting, you know, and then the plane's delayed and then you get to the other end and you've got to wait for an hour for your luggage to come off the carousel, you get into your motorhome and your holiday starts there.
Yeah.
And then when you arrive at the campsite or wherever you're heading for, you make yourself a cup of tea, you get out the chairs, it's hassle-free, you know?
And the community, they are lovely, lovely people.
Yeah.
And it's a bit like stepping back 30 years, 20 years, that everyone speaks to each other. If you run out of tea, somebody brings you a tea bag.
Yes.
And it's just lovely.
And it's a slower pace, isn't it? No one's in a particular hurry because you are literally enjoying the journey.
That's it. You know, some people take sort of electric bikes with them and they can sort of, you know, hang them on the back of the vehicle. So when you get to where you're going, where you're going to be parked up, you can stay there then and then take the electric bikes and explore the local countryside without having to manoeuvre what is essentially a large vehicle down narrow country lanes.
Yeah.
You've got the freedom to nip down to the shops to get a pint of milk or whatever. Just do that on the bike.
Is it somewhat of a test of a relationship, Suki, in that you're sort of in the confined space?
Not really, because we're together so much of the time. You know,
yes,
we work together.
Yeah. All day. All night. Wake up in the morning, there she is.
I just follow him about.
We don't have separate jobs. So, I mean, well, sometimes Suki's doing a gig at night or I'm doing a gig at night. But generally speaking, we are with each other during the day. And they had these little sort of GoPro cameras in the inside the motorhome. So they said, you know, we'll just record you for about an hour as you're driving between places and just talk about anything he wants. So we did. We chat away and laugh and, you know, improvise, I suppose, essentially. And then after a while, it's okay, we've turned them off now. And then we keep going. And I said, you don't have to do any more. I said, no, but this is what we'd like.
This is
what we do.
We spend all day trying to make each other laugh.
We do this the whole time.
The silliest one.
Yeah.
Isn't it lovely that you work together and there's a lovely sort of romantic love story behind your comedy partnership. Can you share with us what you're prepared to about the beginnings of said romance?
Yeah, so yes. We were both on a tour. We ended up going to India to do a tour. And there was a particular day where everyone else had gone out and both Paul and I had come down with the same stomach bug. Mm. So we'd both wandered down to reception and we'd known each other for years, but not well.
No.
Because it turned out Paul fancied me, so never made eye contact and talked to me. So I thought he hated me.
It's always a winner to do that.
It's very adolescent approach.
Yeah, exactly. Totally.
Should have just punched her in the arm to really hammer that message.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Do you want to get a tattoo?
So, and because I thought he didn't like me, I decided I didn't like him. So we didn't speak to each other. We knew each other for about 15 years, but really didn't speak. And then we both were in down in the hotel reception because we couldn't go out and be far away from a toilet. And so I said to Paul, in my ultimate wisdom, I think brandy is meant to be good for an upset stomach. So we ended up drinking...
Which it isn't.
No.
We've made that clear now. It is. We saw a doctor later on who held his head in horror when Suki told him that her cure for an very bad stomach upset was brandy.
Yeah. But I thought, medicinal brandy. Coca-Cola was meant to be good for it.
Yeah.
So we sat and had a couple of brandy and Cokes on a clearly empty stomach, got absolutely off our faces, realised we got on really well. And that night there was a close-up magic show in the garden of the hotel.
Yes.
Right.
Except it was dark and the close-up magician was about 500 metres away, so you could see nothing. So we sat there.
Yeah, it was just hysterical. You could make out this figure in the dark making various gestures. There was no lights on him. And every so often he went, ta-ta! We couldn't see what he'd done.
And we were pissed as puddings, heckling the poor man.
Close-up magic, far-away magic.
Yeah. And that's how our relationship
began. That's how it began.
Yeah.
And how long ago was that?
2004, so 20 years, yeah.
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 Is there a particular song that we could play, representative? Doesn't have to, you know.
Have you got a song called Will It Never End?
How very dare you!
Well, you could see that in an optimistic way.
Well, I was going to pick from a favourite, but I can pick it now.
Yeah.
Go on.
At our wedding, we had a completely non-secular wedding, and we had All You Need Is Love by the Beatles.
Oh, that's a nice one. Like your choice better than Paul's.
Yes. Well, I would, let me see. There's a song by Dr. Hook. Now, I don't know if it was a single, but it was called Everybody's Making It Big But Me.
Oh.
Which is a quite funny song about essentially somebody singing, I've never become famous, I never will, and everybody's making it big but me. I don't know if you can find that, but that's on an album called Bankrupt. It's on one of their greatest hits albums, so maybe you can find it.
Can I just point out, mine was about us.
Yeah.
What was yours about?
Me.
And therein lies the tale of Suki and Paul.
Well, you can't expect a pony to pick good music.
Oh, that stung, I can tell.
That stung, I feel the scar of that.
What about if I ask you both to pick, not necessarily a romantic song, but one that, you know, does genuinely move you, whether that's move you from a state of melancholy to feeling better or get you jazzed for a gig?
Well, another one that we're playing in the show, sometimes just before we go on, that always lifts my heart is another Dr. Hook one. You make my pants want to get up and dance. I mean, that's the best lyric in the world, in one of the best tunes in the world. So that one I absolutely love. It's Raining Men. You can never be anything but happy than you when you hear It's Raining Men. Love
and
that.
And that song starts off with somebody saying, have I got news for you?
Oh, there you go.
That's a good one to pick. What a song which I hadn't, which was a hit back in the mid-70s, but Carol Sayer-Bager, is it?
Bayer-Sager, yeah.
You're Leaving Today, is it called?
Yes.
Which I'd never heard, and I heard it for the first time about 3 or 4 months ago, and it is so catchy and very, very funny. It's about that breakup of a relationship.
Suki,
should I take a hint from this?
You feeling a little nervous?
Jack?
It's more than a hint. It's a subpoena. No, yeah, but it's an unwanted guest being given the you're leaving or something. I can't remember what it's called now. But
I raise you, I will survive.
Yes, good. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. You will. Yeah, yeah.
I like the musical improv. That's fantastic, guys. Thank you so much for joining us today.
No, thank you.
What would your final words of encouragement be to anybody who'd perhaps never been to the Edinburgh Fringe or the Edinburgh Festival, generally speaking? What would you say is the big attraction?
Oh my God, it is just fantastic. Just come, you'll have a great time. There's so much to see, so much to do. It's got a lovely, friendly atmosphere.
And take a chance occasionally on a show which you like the sound of, but you're not sure exactly what it is. Because it could either be the best thing you've ever seen or the worst. I saw something up here when I first came up as a member of the public in 1980. It was one of the worst shows I've ever seen, and it's burnt into my memory. And whenever I think about it, I can't help but smile. It was really awful.
Well, nobody's ever said that about your show.
No, that's no, no, absolutely. You.
Enjoy the next week. You've got another week to go of the show, and we'd encourage anybody to come and watch the show. Paul Merton and Suki Webster's improv show. It's on at 3:30. At the Pleasance Grand.
Every day till
19th.
August
19th.
Yeah. Yeah. Brilliant.
Cheers, guys.
And we'll probably still be together then, won't we?
Well, we'll see, apparently.
She's putting in a call to the lawyer just in case.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.